we're talking about Trump declaring a national emergency, which, according to most of the news coverage, is an even bigger national emergency. Now, there are a few angles you can cover this from. First, the can he do that angle, to which France 24 2 hours ago reported.
You heard Donald Trump say he's going to win in the courts. Is that true?
I think it is likely true that he will, mostly because the statute at issue, the National Emergency Act, doesn't define emergency.
It is never a good sign when your legal argument has to start with Webster's Dictionary defines emergency as. So that was quite the oversight. But yeah, because the legislation defining rules that govern emergencies doesn't clarify what an emergency is, it's gonna be an uphill battle saying that this isn't an emergency. Now, if the Senate and House both pass a resolution with a two-thirds veto-proof majority, they can rescind the president's emergency declaration. But, I mean, if your plan involves Congress successfully coming together to get something done, I'd get a new plan. The next way to cover this is to try and answer the question of what can the president do with this emergency power? And there is a lot of irrelevant yet scary-sounding abilities, including the president can unilaterally suspend the law that bars government from the testing of biological and chemical agents on unwitting human subjects. I love how at some point in history, legislators all got together and thought, you know, a national emergency would just be a great time to start testing new chemical agents on human subjects. That's definitely gonna help this situation. The stuff that will make you want to double wrap your tinfoil hat, though, is generally not relevant to the conversation of building a wall. What's the focus on today is money and land, two things that I covered extensively in a recent episode. And yes, I did reuse that button for today's logo. It was just too fitting. The major goal of this emergency declaration is...
With that confirmation, President Trump is declaring a national emergency, freeing up funding for a border wall.
Now, it's not like declaring a state of emergency would allow Trump to just start printing cash or look at the official congressional budget and say, nah. Instead, he can take money from the military to fund his wall. Specifically, the Pentagon was ready with roughly $3 billion in funds. That's all money that Congress has given the Pentagon that has not yet been allocated to a specific military project. If that doesn't sound like much money, there's an additional $700 million under a separate statute designed to provide federal funds to federal law enforcement agencies at the border for counter-drug activities. Beyond that, though, he's gonna have to start defunding existing military projects in order to fund a wall. So, okay. Now that we have a basic idea of what this emergency declaration does and its legal standing, let's get into the spin zone. Starting with everybody's biggest concern right now, the growing crisis at the border. Oh, wait, I'm actually being told it's...
Speaker Pelosi pointed to the Parkland shooting and gun violence as an example.
That's a national emergency. Why don't you declare that emergency, Mr. President? I wish you would. But a Democratic president can do that. Democratic president can declare emergencies as well.
I'm sorry, but everybody just acted like, oh, wow, well, checkmate. But nobody ever asked the follow-up question, how? Not how would you be able to declare a state of emergency over that, because yeah, you can do that really quickly. But how would that national emergency declaration help? I mean, people always treat this like, well, the president can declare a national emergency. Should we just bow down to our great leader now, or wait for him to declare a national emergency that not enough people are bowing down to him? If you wanted to declare gun violence a national emergency, you could get a few billion dollars in funds from the military, apparently slip some Prozac into our water supply without telling anybody, and deploy US troops domestically to defend people against gun violence. It would be similar to sending troops to Alabama to enforce integration or Los Angeles during the Rodney King riots. You could declare martial law, but you can't take guns away, something America tried to do during Hurricane Katrina and quickly lost a court case about it. So it might be a slippery slope, but it's a much more specific slippery slope than people are reporting. The broader issue, though, is, according to presidential historian Doris Kearns Goodwin,
I think we're left with a situation that it's a very difficult thing, then, to call a national emergency if you don't have the facts on your side, if you haven't been able to persuade the people, excuse me, that what you're doing is necessary for the country's security.
What a mild-mannered way to just savagely insult this declaration of emergency. Well, it's going to be hard if the facts and the people disagree with you. This does bite at a bigger point, though. What is a national emergency? And it's weirder than you would think. Take, for example, the critical August 17, 2001 issue when the Export Administration Act of 1979 expired without Congress renewing it. So, we declared a national emergency. Phew, glad we all got through that one intact. In fact, now that I'm looking at it, 22 of the 32 of these emergency national declarations since the passing of that act are just blocking actors from foreign countries from putting property in America and transacting with us. In fact, the main states of emergency declarations most people would probably look at and say, yeah, that checks out, are A, a declaration of national emergency by reason of certain terrorist attacks on September 14th, 2001. Which, 9/11. And of course, this past September when Trump declared a state of emergency to sanction individuals who engage in election interference?
We have important breaking news. The Treasury Department has just announced new sanctions on Russia. Certain Russian entities, five entities, 19 individuals implicated in I'm going to quote here, attempted interference in U.S. elections.
Yeah, what the reports didn't tell you right there was, apparently, we were declaring a state of national emergency to do that. Which, well, that's weirdly self-aware for this administration. I'm just pointing this out because I want to clarify what the offensive part of this action is. Most critics seem to say we should be waiting for... before you declare a national emergency. But we generally declare it on pretty minor stuff. The controversial point here is that we're using these powers to directly act in opposition to what Congress wanted, in an area where, constitutionally, they should have control. This brings me to my final point, because this emergency declaration is actually adjacent to a legitimately dangerous potential national emergency. Drugs. I'm a 90s kid, so I know.
This is your brain. This is drugs.
Yeah. Drugs are bad, brains are delicious, we get it. So, is there an invasion of drugs coming into this country? I remember last year you declared...
On Thursday, he declared that the opioid crisis in the United States was a public health emergency. Although he fell short of announcing a national emergency on what has been described by some as an epidemic.
Oh yeah, I remember that a year ago when people actually wanted you to declare a national emergency over drugs. You know, so you could have freed up some additional funds to help addicts. Well, now we have a new approach of building a wall to protect us from the drug invasion. Unfortunately, if you want to just zero in for a second on overdose deaths, well, the call's coming from inside the House, because according to the DEA's 2018 National Drug Threat Assessment, controlled prescription drugs remain responsible for the largest number of overdose deaths of any illicit drug class since 2001. So maybe we rethink our wall strategy, just tweak it a little bit, and put the wall back in Walgreens. I don't want to completely poo-poo this notion that there isn't an increase of drugs coming from the southern border, though. Because from all accounts, that number is going up really quickly, especially with heroin, a problem that a year ago we all united around and said, yeah, that probably is a national emergency. Unfortunately, in this case, well, most people don't seem to think that building a wall is the answer.
According to the DEA, most drugs come into the U.S. through legal points of entry, ports or existing border crossings in cars, tractor trailers, and ships. Elaborate tunnels are the next most common way that drugs come into the U.S., and those tunnels can always get deeper. Plus, a wall isn't likely to curb the number of deaths from drug overdoses. Most of these deaths are from prescription drugs, which aren't trafficked across the border.
Well, okay, there's a lot to unpack there. First, there's U.S. Customs and Border Statistics. The majority of drug imports come through existing ports of entry? Honestly, not sure why. That sounds like a terrible plan when we have the Big Ben just sitting right there wall-less. But hey, that's why you're a billionaire drug lord and I'm a YouTube reporter. I looked up the DEA report, and to add some specificity, because majority could be anything between 51% and 100%, with smuggling patterns, we see 90% of heroin at ports of entry, 88% of cocaine, 87% of methamphetamine, and 80% of fentanyl going through ports of entry. Hey, that other 10 to 20% though, we can take a small dent out of by building a massive wall. Now, I will be fair and say,
when you listen to politicians, in particular certain Democrats, they say it all comes through the port of entry. It's wrong. It's wrong. It's just a lie. It's all a lie.
I really tried to figure out what he was talking about, but our Drug Enforcement Agency, our Customs and Border Protection, both issued reports covering 2018 that disagree with that, as well as sworn testimony from Trump's then DHS Secretary John Kelly. But hey, maybe they're all lying. To sum all this up, we're getting a few billion dollars from military projects to build a border wall. Which, oh no, where's the Department of Defense gonna find $3 billion to replace that with? All of this is despite Congress's best efforts to limit the president's wall-building capabilities. Although there's not much they can do unless two-thirds of them unite against the president. Which, good luck there. The biggest fears are setting a new precedent of presidents having czarist control over the populace. That's right, doesn't have to always be Nazis. A more realistic fear, though, would be of the president taking a few billion dollars from a military cookie jar to go against Congress to fund a vanity project. Which is still a problem, but a little less intimidating. Lastly, we do have a very real drug crisis tied to the southern border that a wall plan seems almost calculated to not efficiently address. Thank you, and that's all I have to say about that. Hello YouTube, I hope you enjoyed this video. If you want to support independent, nonpartisan news, remember to subscribe by clicking on this floating logo to the right of my head. Ring that bell so that freedom will continue to ring, and give me a thumbs up if you like what you saw. Lastly, as always, thank you for watching.